സാർ എല്ലാവരും അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യാണ് സർ.
യെസ് യെസ്,
എല്ലാവരും അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യാണ്, അല്ല മ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യണം സാർ, മ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യണം.
So welcome back.
Yes, sir. Sir, please unmute. Sir. Please. Yes, yes.
So, yes. Now we will continue. So what I so we have covered earlier topics. Now we are coming to Section 20 deals with the discretion given to the courts. What does Section 20 say? Because I told you earlier that just a moment.
Sir, please carry on. By that time, I shall take the.
Yes, yes. Now, what I told you was that under Section 10. 14, 16, there were elements of discretion, especially under Section 10. Now, what is the scope of discretion? When the court is conferred with the discretion under Section 10, or court was conferred with the discretion, should not there be some limit or some provision as to what exactly is the scope of that discretion? So that it will not be misused by the courts. So Section 20 dealt with the scope of discretion. So what I'm trying to make you understand is that earlier provisions gave wide discretion to the courts under the 1963 Act. At the same time, statute wanted to lay down the limits within which the discretionary power had to be exercised. So Section 20 was introduced, or Section 20 lays down the limits within which the discretion has to be exercised. So original Section 20 provided that the right to grant specific performance was discretionary, but courts are not under an obligation to grant relief of specific performance merely because it was lawful to do so. Discretion shall not be arbitrary, but shall be sound and reasonable, based on legal principles and capable of correction by an appellate court. This was the original Section 20. Now, if you look at the computer, you will see that what is Section 20? Section 20 says the jurisdiction to decree specific performance is discretionary, and the court is not bound to grant such a relief merely because it is lawful to do so. But the discretion of the court is not arbitrary, but sound and reasonable, guided by judicial principles and capable of correction by a court of appeal. So just see how the statute has defined the discretion powers given to the courts. Discretion to court, first it says discretion is the granting of this specific performance is discretionary. Then starts the limitations, but the court is not bound to grant such a relief merely because it is lawful to do so. Then again it says the discretionary power should not be arbitrary. The court shall not say that I feel that he is entitled for. No, it should be based on sound and legal, sound and reasonable, guided by judicial principles and capable of correction by a court of appeal. So in total, Section 20 provides the limitations for exercising the discretionary power. It says that it should be based on legal and sound principles, legal, reasonable, judicial principles, and capable of corruption by a court of appeal. What does it indicate? When the statute says that it should be, the exercise of discretion should be capable of correction by an appeal, means the court exercising the discretion should give its reasons as to why the discretion is exercised. Say, for example, if the court arrives at the conclusion that there is a contract, that the contract was a valid contract, defendant violated the terms of the contract, and for these and these reasons, I refuse to grant presumed performance. And that must not be an arbitrary use of a power. It must be based on legal exercise of power. It must be supported by reasons. Only if they are supported by the reasons, the court sitting in appeal will be capable of correcting it. That's why I said the court shall not merely say, I feel that the plaintiff is entitled to get the relief, so I'm granting the relief. I feel that the plaintiff is not entitled to get relief, so I'm not granting the discretionary relief. I'm only ordering compensation. So Section 20 limits or put guidelines to the exercise of discretionary power by the court. That was the significance of Section 20 as it originally stood under the 1963 Act. Now, I told you, the impact of amendment of Section 10, 14 and 16 was that it took away the wide discretion given to the courts. When the wide discretion given to the courts is taken away, why should there be a provision relating to discretion? That's why, consequently, Section 20 has also been amended, and the entire provision relating to Section discretion has been deleted. And now the present Section 20 deals with substituted performance of the contract and nothing about discretion. Now we will go to the new section.
That's it.
Yes. No, this is not the... Yes. Now, without prejudice to the generality of the provisions contained in the Indian Contract Act, and except as otherwise agreed upon by the parties, where the contract is broken due to the non-performance of the promise by any party, the party who suffers by such breach shall have the option of substituted performance through a third party or by his own agency and recover the expenses and other costs actually incurred, spent or suffered by him by the party committing such breach. No substitute performance of contract under subsection 1 shall be undertaken unless the party who suffered such a breach has given a notice in writing, etc. So this is what I told you earlier. The present Section 20 does not speak about the discretion, because the discretionary powers are gone. Then it refers to this one new concept known as substituted performance of the contracts. As I told you earlier, when there is a contract and breach is committed by one person, the other person who is willing to perform his part of the contract may call upon the other side to perform his part of the contract, and that if he does not fail to do so within 30 days, I will get it done through my employees or by a third party. Then if that substituted performance is obtained, what is the relief available to the person who gets substituted performance? If he has sustained any loss or damages consequently, or he had incurred more expenses for getting it done, he will be entitled to get the cost recovered from the other side. So this is a very, very drastic provision, a very new provision, and a new relief is given to the party concerned. so that virtually the scope of a suit for specific performance will be taken away by invoking Section 20. Even without going to a court of law, you can get it done. But I will also tell you that it is a very, very dangerous provision now because of various reasons. Now, what is the impact of it? You can get the work done, but always you will not be able to get it done because, as I told you, if I engage, there are certain works which cannot be performed by any other person. Say, for example, an agreement for sale of an immovable property. How can substituted performance be done? It cannot be. It can be done only by filing a suit for specific performance and getting the property transferred in favor of the plaintiff. It cannot be performed by substituted performance. On the other hand, if it is relating to supply of goods or for, say, construction of a building, erection of a machinery, etc., probably it can be done through another person. Now, why I said it was a dangerous provision means, suppose, I'll put it this way, Section 20 does not give any guidelines as to how the substituted performance is to be done. Say, for example, I have entered into a contract with the builder to construct a house for me, and he fails to commit a loss, commit to perform the contract. Can I go to a builder who is very expensive and get the work done in accordance with the plan and license obtained by me and incurring more expenses, thereby imposing a very heavy burden on the person who committed the breach? These are questions which are to be decided by the court of law. The statute does not give any indication as to how it should be performed. Is there any limit to enforcement of performance, etc.? So we have to wait till the provisions, the scope of this provision is explained by court. But I will tell you, that's a very, very important provision, a new relief given to the parties who are aggrieved. So this is known as the substituted performance of contracts. Now we have covered all the modern amendments. Then few new provisions have come in. One is under Section 14A. What you have to understand is that new Section 14A. Now you must have noted one aspect. The nature of the suits have become more complex. We have now contracts relating to various activities. More complex contracts are coming into building contracts, construction of big establishments, etc. So that in certain types of contracts, the court may not be able to have the expert, may require certain experts, expert opinion. Section 14A provides for appointment of experts. So it gives a wide power to the court to appoint experts. Say, for example, for accounting purpose, an expert can be appointed. For engineering aspect, regarding architectural aspects, regarding scientific aspects, experts can be required wherever it is required, and the court can get a report from the expert, and he can also be examined in the court of law to prove his opinion. Of course, it is not the expert opinion under the Indian Evidence Act, but that's a new provision which is intended to assist the court in evaluating, anticipating that more complex types of litigations are likely to come in future because of the development of science and technology, because of the various new technologies being adopted in the course of transactions. So called anticipating that it has been introduced. Then a new concept that has been brought under the new Specific Relief Act of 2018 is the concept of infrastructure contracts. New schedule has been added to the Specific Relief Act, which deals with infrastructure contracts. What are the infrastructure contracts? All those activities which are mentioned in the schedule, like construction of big buildings, dams, roads, hydroelectric projects, aerodrome, atomic power station, etc. These are brought under the campus of the schedule and they are called as infrastructure projects. And new provisions have been introduced in the statute in relation to infrastructure projects, because the parliament has felt that in relation to infrastructure projects which are essential for the growth of the country, specific provision should be incorporated. Accordingly, section 20A, 20B and 20C, three new provisions are introduced. Section 20A that relates to infrastructure projects. 20A, can we go to that, Mr. Thangachan?
No. Yes, sir.
That relates to reliefs in just above that. Yes. Just see what the section 20A says. No injunction shall be granted by a court in a suit under this act involving a contract relating to an infrastructure project. What is infrastructure project? It is a project designated or mentioned in schedule, the new schedule, to an infrastructure project specified in the schedule, comma, where granting of injunction would cause impediment or delay in the progress or completion of such infrastructure project. So that it puts a bar on the right of a court while granting injunctions in relation to infrastructure projects. Court shall not grant injunction. Is it an absolute injunction, absolute bar? Just refer to that. Court shall not grant injunction in relation to any infrastructure project. Is it so? Can anybody tell me whether it is an absolute bar or is the court barred from granting any injunction in relation to any infrastructure project? What's your opinion? No. Yes, it is no, because it shall not grant injunction in relation if the injunction would cause impediment or delay in the progress or completion of such infrastructure. Only if there is it is likely to cause any impediment or delay, the injunction cannot be granted. But if an injunction is not likely to cause any impediment or in the progress of infrastructure project, such injunctions can be granted. It's not an absolute bar. But at the same time, that shows the significance of infrastructure projects. So 20A is a new provision. Then 20B, still the court can exercise discretionary powers. Yes, definitely. As Mr. Krishna Verma has said, the court can still exercise the inherent power in case of emergency. That right is not taken away. Then we come to section 20B, which relates to constitution of new courts. The state government, in consultation with the Chief Justice of High Court, shall designate by notification official gazette one or more civil courts as special courts within the local limits of the area to exercise jurisdiction and to try suit under this act in respect of a contract in relating to infrastructure projects. So those courts are designated courts which shall try matters relating to infrastructure projects. So infrastructure project courts. The 20C puts a time limit for time limit to suits under the Specific Relief Act. Notwithstanding anything, that is 12 months is the time limit plus 6 months extension. Notwithstanding anything contained in the CPC, a suit filed under the provisions of this Act shall be disposed of by the court within a period of 12 months from the date of service of summons to the defendant, provided that the period may be extended for a further period not exceeding 6 months in the aggregate after according to the reasons. Now, what you have to understand is that this time limit applies to every suit under the Specific Relief Act, not confined to infrastructure projects alone or infrastructure suits alone. Whereas 20B, the special court is to deal with infrastructure suits relating to infrastructure project alone. That's the difference. So 20A, 14A, experts, 20A, bar against granting injunction, 20B, special courts for infrastructure projects, 20C, the time limit for disposal of suits under the Specific Relief Act. I think these are the principles governing the new provisions. Now, so I think you understood these provisions. I will just refer to one topic, which is you always say that in relation to specific performance of the contracts or in relation to immovable property or a contract for performance, time is the essence of the contract or time is not the essence of the contract. Both ways you say. What is meant by the concept of time is the essence of the contract? What does it mean? Probably all of you use that time is the essence of the contract. What does it mean? Mr. Krishna Verma, I think you can.
Then it's an unmute.
Unmute.
Yes.
Mr. Krishna Verma, what is your answer? What is meant by the time is the essence of the contract?
Sir, in my opinion, suppose I want to sell my property, 2 cents or 3 cents of property for the purpose of carrying out the marriage of my daughter. That is specifically mentioned in the contract, agreement for sale of the immovable property. That time is very essential because without getting the money fully, I will not be able to. In such case, time should be the essence of the contract.
So as a time is the essence of the contract means time is the most essential part of the contract. Or yes. In other words, when we say that time is the essence of the contract or time is not the essence of the contract.
And that should be mentioned specifically in the agreement itself.
Now is it essentially required? I'll put it this way. So that we call it, say that time is the essence of the contract. Or in other words, question is, even if you prescribe a time limit in the agreement, is it required that if or whether it will make any difference if the performance is not done within the stipulated time? To decide that, whether the time will have any impact or the time limit prescribed by the parties by the very fact that time it has not been completed within the time limit prescribed, can you treat the contract as become non-performant or impossible of performance, or that it has not been performed, it has been violated, etc.? The question that arises is whether time is the essence of the contract, whether the parties intended to treat the time as the essence of the contract. That's the question. Generally, we say that in relation to immovable properties, time is not the essence of the contract. So that even within the time limit, it is not performed, that may not make much difference. And in the case of sale of immovable property, normally we say that time is the essence of the contract. This is the general principle only. But as Mr. Kishorba said, there may be cases wherein that even in the case of immovable property, time will be the essence of the contract. As he said, the agreement is the property is sold for conducting the marriage of the daughter of the seller. And then we treat it as the essence of the contract. But the question is it necessary that it should be specifically mentioned in the contract that time will be the essence of the contract?
The general principle is that it must be the intention of the seller must be informed fully well.
Correct. It need not be mentioned in the agreement that the time is
brought to the notice of the vendee at the time of contract itself, sir.
Correct. Whether the parties understood that time is the essence of the contract is an essential thing. Say, for example, I'm selling the property to, suppose the agreement says that the seller has received a notice from the bank to discharge the liability with a rider that if it is not paid within the stipulated time, it will probably will be sold. That's the reason why I'm selling the property. Probably indicate that time is the essence of the contract. Yes. Now, where is it provided in the statute? That the concept of time is the essence of the contract, which provision of the specific relief act deals with that? Can anybody tell me? Which provision of the statute refer to that? You will not find it from the specific relief act because it is nowhere mentioned in the statute. It is a general concept.
It is a concept under contract act here.
Not under the specific relief act.
Contract act, yes.
Now, there is a decision of the Supreme Court which laid down this principle. That's a constitutional bench decision known as Chandrani's case. Chandrani. The citation I will give you, Chandrani versus Kamal Rani. Chandrani versus Kamal Rani, 1993, 1 SEC, 519. Chandrani versus Kamal Rani, 1993, 1 SEC, 519. In that decision, the constitutional bench of the Supreme Court referred to the question whether time is the essence of the time, what is the significance of the time mentioned in the statute, etc., in the contract, and gave the principle, laid down the principle that normally it is treated that in the case of immovable property, time is not the essence of the contract, whereas normally in the case of mobile property, time will be the essence of the contract. Then what happened? This was the law that we follow even now. But one decision came later. That is in K.S. Vidyanatham. K.S. Vidyanatham and others versus Vairavan. V-A-I-R-A-V-A-N. Vairavan, 1997. 3 SEC 1. K.S. Vidyanatham and others versus Vairavan, 1997, 3 SEC 1. Then in that case, what the Supreme Court said was that, though Chandrani's case, the Supreme Court said that time is not the essence of the contract in relation to immovable properties. That was rendered by the Constitutional Bench at a time when the value of the properties remained static. Inflation was also not there at that point of time. So that time, in the case of immovable property, time could not be considered as the essence of the contract. But the Supreme Court held the view that nowadays, the value of the properties have increased considerably, especially in the case of cities. So that we need to have a relook into the question of whether time is the essence of the contract in relation to immovable properties. Because that makes a huge difference. That was the law, that was the indicator, that is not the law, but it was commented by the Supreme Court that we need to have a relook into the law laid down by the in Chatrani's case. But since that being a judgment of a two judges bench, even we are bound by the concept of Chatrani. Then came another decision in Sharadamani Kandappan. Sharadamani Kandappan. SARADAMANI. Sharadamani Kandappan. KANDAPPAN. Kandappan versus S. Rajalakshmi and others. 2011. 12 SCC. 2011. 12 SCC, page 18. In that, the Supreme Court said, the Supreme Court almost followed the earlier decision, comment, observation made in Vidyadhadam's case, and said that the concept of time is the essence of the contract needs a relook. Because nowadays, the prices of properties go up very fast, especially in cities and towns. Secondly, the money value is going down because of the inflation. Cost of living index has gone up. So taking into consideration these aspects, the concept of time is not the essence of the contract in case of immovable property. She needs a relook. Let's wait. Whether another constitutional bench decision will lay down the other proposition now. Now, this has got a lot of significance also, practical significance. Because as you know, parties may enter into contract relating to immovable properties or mobile properties. Litigation will take a long time. In the meanwhile, value of the property will go up. How to synchronize, how to balance the interest of both sides. These issues do come up. And one typical example I will give you, that citation is Nirmala Anand's case. Nirmala Anand versus Advent Corporation. Nirmala Anand versus Advent Corporation. 2002, 8 SEC, 146. 2002, 8 SEC, 146. In that case, what happened was that Nirmala Anand entered into a contract for purchase of a flat constructed by Advent Corporation in Bombay. The agreement was in the year 1966. The price agreed was 60,000 rupees. So she entered into an agreement to purchase a flat in Bombay for 60,000 rupees in the year 1966. Property was not constructed and there were certain disputes regarding delay in the completion of the building. Matter went up to the trial court. Court decreed the suit in favor of this lady, Then matter went up in appeal. Then it was taken in second appeal. Then the matter came up to the Supreme Court. Because in second appeal, what the Supreme Court, in all the courts, held the view that though there was an agreement, there was a violation by Advent Corporation, the value of property has increased manifold in Bombay. So that if specific performance is ordered in favor of Nirmala Anand for a sum of rupees 60,000 of a property which has increased manifold, it will be unjust. When the matter came up before the Supreme Court, after how many years the matter came up before Supreme Court? Decision is of 2002. Agreement of 1966. After 36 years, the matter came up before the Supreme Court. Supreme Court said that the delay in the litigation may be due to various reasons. Ultimately, the contract was valid. Violation was from the side of the builder. So necessarily, she should be entitled to get the relief. But at the same time, the value of the property has gone up. Can you deny the relief in favor of a person on the ground that value has gone up? Court said no. But at the same time, we cannot forget about the fact that the value of flats in Bombay has increased so much. So the court exercised this discretion and granted a conditional decree in favor of Nirmala Anand by saying that you pay 6 lakhs rupees more to the builder. So thereby, a new principle of balancing the equities was evolved by the Supreme Court. That is the significance of Nirmala Anand's case. Now what happened was that the same principle was adopted by the Supreme Court in two other subsequent decisions. They are K. Prakash versus Sambat Kumar, 2015, 1 SEC 597. And Zarina Siddiqui, SIDDIQI, versus A. Ramalingam, 2015, 1 SEC 705. These two decisions followed the decision laid down in Nirmala Anand's case that court can mold the equity. Court can grant the relief by balancing the equities. So that's it. Now we come to the last topic, but the most crucial topic. Question is, we have discussed about 2018 amendment. Is the act retrospective? That's the question. There is no provision in the 2018 act which says whether it is prospective or retrospective. There is no transitional provision also. We find that also in some statutes. Till the new statute is introduced, the earlier provision will continue something like this. That would have given some indication. Now the question is it retrospective? I will tell you, as far as we are concerned, if the act is retrospective, what will be the consequence? At least for today's discussion, whatever I have been telling for the last 2 hours will become redundant. Discretion relief, time is the essence of the contract, etc. will become redundant because the new statute applies retrospectively to all the pending suits. So you do not, we can just forget about the discretionary powers of the court, what is meant by equity principle, pleading and proving, time is the essence of contract, etc. What is your answer? Now, Ms. Priyadarshini says it is only prospective. What is the reason? Or Advocate CO Rajan says that substituted performance. Yes, Mr. Abdul Karim says it is retrospective since remedial. I think what is the majority view it seems? Yes. Can somebody come up and say what is your view on that? Explain it. Educate Usha Kumari, your view is that it is a retrospective. Why do you say that? Can you explain it to Educate? You have given your answer, but substantiate your answer. Can anybody volunteer and give me the answer for the benefit of all?
You can raise your hand so that I can unmute you.
Unmute, yes. Yes, so Mr. Merlo, George Merlo, what is your answer?
You can unmute now, please.
See, in any act, it must be specifically mentioned that it is a retrospective. Huh. Unless it is specified, it is prospective.
No, that I may not agree with that, because it need not, because if that be so, you know that there are several decisions which say that procedural law is retrospective, and substantive law is prospective, procedural law is retrospective. Okay. That's how the law is, it is considered whether the statute is prospective or not. There are so many statutes which do not specifically say whether it is retrospective or not. That's why the courts are called upon to decide the question whether it is a procedural nature or substantive in nature. So that merely because it is not mentioned, you cannot say that it is prospective only. Yes, anybody else? Mr. Bowen has given the reason that it is a procedural law, so that it's a retrospective. Yes. There are one principle which I said. Normally, procedural laws are retrospective. Substantive law is prospective. Substantive law is prospective. Procedural laws are retrospective unless otherwise provided.
Sir, Mr. Jairam wants to say something.
Mr. Jairam, what do you say?
Please unmute Jairam, please.
Can only be prospective.
Why?
There is creation of new rights and taking away of new rights. Creation of new rights. Taking away powers of the court. Entirely new situation is brought into force.
Because parties are under. What is a new right conferred? What is a new liability created?
Your Lordship, parties are under. Taking into account the question of pleading, a plaintiff is in an advantageous position now.
Yeah.
It was not there before. So this is a new right.
No, the question of pleading, then is it not mere procedural? Because whether you should plead it or not, is it a substantive one?
And your Lordship, the discretion also.
Discretion is taken away. Discretion, is it a substantive right?
That is there, Your Lordship, because once the exercise of discretion by the court is the right for the party, judicial discretion.
In one sense, I may agree with you on that. Yes. Then anybody? Yes, somebody has said Priya. Substituted performance, yes. Somebody has said about
then your Lordship, yes, exactly. This substituted performance, it's a new right. Here.
Is it a new right? It's a new relief.
New relief. It's a right to, even without going to the court, one is able to get his relief.
Yeah.
Just like surface, Your Lordship.
That's a new, I may say that it is a new remedy or a new relief. Can you say that we are, it is a substantive provision? Now, just before, since all of you referred to substitute performance, I'll just tell you one thing. If, as a lawyer, all of you have to be very careful in drafting the agreements hereafter. You have always to keep in your mind the possibility of Section 20 being invoked by the other side. So what you have to do is that in every contract which you execute, which you adopt or draft for your clients, you should clearly specify what are the limits of exercise of substituted performance. You have to be very, very careful in drafting such agreements. Otherwise, you should always keep in your mind that in future, Section 20 will be raised by the other side and that will be at your risk. So that you should say that if at all substituted performance is invoked, that should be done by a contractor for the same amount, same specification, without any higher financial burden, something like that. You should have to be careful. As a lawyer, it's your duty. Otherwise,
excuse me, sir. Pradrishni wants to add something.
Who? Yes.
Sir, if it is made retrospective, whether the court can reinstate all the cases which has been decided, and based upon that, whether they can direct for the substitute performance.
Tell me, repeat that and not follow that.
If it is made a retrospective effect, if the amendment has given a retrospective effect, whether the cases pending before the courts can direct substitute performance without an amendment in the pleadings.
Naturally. But there's one thing. That question will not arise at all, because substituted performance has to be done before coming to the court. Section 20 applies. You have to, when there is a breach, you have to issue notice. 30 days notice is mandatory. Then, if you get, so that in a pending suit, after
that's
having come to the court, you cannot grant, ask the party to do for specific.
That's what I'm saying, sir. That substitute service cannot be made effective in such cases if the retrospective effect is made.
And now, do we decide like that? This will not be possible. We are unmindful of what will be the impact of. If it results in heartburn,
yes,
it is prospective only. No, that's not how we analyze that. We adopt certain parameters. One, whether statute doesn't give any indication. Secondly, whether it is procedural law or not. If it is a substantive law, you always say it is prospective. Then the question comes whether this is a substantive law or a procedural law. So we'll answer that first. Then we will come to your question, that substituted performance will not apply in a bidding suit. That you can be sure. Not because of prospectivity, but because it can apply only before the parties go up to the court.
As it is a procedural law, it can be considered only as retrospective. Because
that's the question. Who said that it is a procedural law? Is CPC a procedural law or a substantive law?
It is procedural law.
Completely. Is it so? No. It is procedural, then there are certain provisions which are substantive in nature. Your right to appeal.
Yes, it is.
Is it not? Your right to file an appeal is a right, substantive right.
Yes.
Your right to file a second appeal, if it involves substantial questions of law, you are entitled to. Within limitation period, if an appeal is provided, you are entitled to file. So that is substantive right is also the, though we generally call it procedural law.
This, the shifting of the replacing, I mean, deleting the discretion gives us an entirely new scenario.
Yeah, that's true.
And
that's
your lordship, this adjudication, the process of adjudication has undergone a sea change.
Yeah. Now, I understood you. I'm not answering you, Mr. Jairam.
Yes.
Because I will refer to a few other provisions, then we will come back.
Yes.
Anybody who has got a different view? Now, though Mr. Jayaram and most of others, you said that it can only be prospective. I think majority view is that it should be prospective only. Yes. Now, what I'll tell you, I'll give you four decisions, and tell you how whether you have changed your opinion or not. The first decision is a Calcutta High Court decision. A.R. Maulavi Ali Hossain. Maulavi, M-O-U-L-V-I. Maulavi Ali, A-L-I, Hossain, H-O-S-S-A-I-N. Maulavi Ali Hossain versus Rajkumar Haldar. Rajkumar Haldar. AR 1943, Calcutta, 417. AR 1943, Calcutta, 417. Then Hanumanth Rao Deshmukh. Hanumanth Rao Deshmukh versus Krishna Bai. 1986, 1 Bombay. CR 50, page 50. In this Calcutta decision and Bombay decision, certain amendments brought to the 1877 Specific Relief Act was under challenge. The question that came up was the amendments introduced to section 1877 Specific Relief Act, whether it was retrospective or prospective. Identical question came up. Both the courts, Calcutta High Court and Bombay High Court, said that it is retrospective in nature because it is a procedural law. Specific Relief Act was a procedural law. I'll repeat the citation. Hanumanth Rao Deshmukh versus Krishna Bai is 1986, 1 Bombay, 86, 1 Bombay, CR 50. Being a procedural law. Then another decision came up in 1971. That is in Radheshyam, R-A-D-H-E-S-H-Y-A-M. Radheshyam Kamila, K-A-M-I-L-A. Radheshyam Kamila versus Kiran Bala. Radheshyam Kamila versus Kiran Bala. AR 1971, Calcutta, 341. In that, amendments brought to the 1963 Specific Relief Act was in question. In that also, the question came up whether the amendments introduced to 1963 Specific Relief Act were retrospective in nature or not. Calcutta High Court held that it is retrospective since Specific Relief Act is a procedural law. Again, so three decisions, same view. Then comes a Supreme Court decision, that is Aadhunik Steels Limited. Aadhunik, A-D-H-U-N-I-K, Aadhunik Steels Limited versus Orissa Manganese and Minerals Private Limited. Orissa Manganese and Minerals Private Limited. Aadhunik Steels Limited versus Orissa Manganese and Minerals Private Limited. 2007, 7 SCC 125. In that case also, not with reference to any amendment, Supreme Court held the view that specific relief act is a procedural law. If we go by all these decisions, what will be the impact? Now, I'll tell you why a specific relief act is called as a procedural law. Generally, the view that it is a procedural law was that it lays down the remedies. Say, for example, in the case of a specific performance of a contract, the substantive law is the contract act. In relation to the contract, specific relief act provides for the remedies, so that it relates to the reliefs. Thereby, it can only be a procedural law. This is the concept. Now, applying these four decisions, what is your view now? Whether the specific relief act of 2018 is retrospective or not? What do you say, Mr. Jairam? Have you changed your view?
Retrospective.
All of you agree?
Yes.
Don't go by that decision alone. But still, you hold the same view as you said earlier. Mr. Jairam, yes. You have to unmute, Mr. Thangachan and Mr. Jairam.
Sir, I still have doubts about it.
Why?
Because of this new adjudication.
Yes.
New adjudication.
What do you say, Mr. Just let us see. I hear others also. Mr. Shiva Sadish, you hold the view that it is a prospective only. Why? Shiva Sadish? I think he has given an opinion that it is prospective only.
Yes.
The act already taken away the discretion powers and puts the limits, and within the limits only the discretion power shall be executed by the court.
Then so, how you will get over Aadhunik Steels Limited case?
That is in 2007, sir, not 2008.
No, it says procedure law.
Previously, it may be, but after the amendment, I think.
Then Priyadarshini, you also said procedural. And again, Priyadarshini, you are given a view that, yes, let us see. Anybody else who wants to add something to what I said?
Not accept it is a retrospective, sir.
It is not. You have changed your view now.
No, already I have stated it is prospective, but sir, you have stated that being a procedural law, it will be.
No, I did not say. I did not say that it is a procedural law. I said the decision is there. Say so. I did not express my view on that.
Sir, but as a specific relief act, based on many decisions, it is considered as a procedural law. I say.
That is why I gave you the hint of CPC. Though we call it a procedure law, there are substantive provisions also.
But I cannot accept it as an retrospective effect. Only a prospective effect can be given to this.
No, I will give the actual the view which I feel my view. Now see, just you take Section 10. Section 10 gives a wide discretion. Wide discretion to the courts by providing that it shall be only discretion relief, or in relation to breach of contracts, the discretion given to the court, discretion is given. And there are two presumptions, two situations. One, when substituted, there is no standard exists for evaluating the damages. Substitute the specific relief act, specific performance can be ordered. Otherwise, if no damages cannot be the adequate compensation, then also specific relief can be ordered. Then it gives thereby it gives certain defenses to the defendant. by saying that time is the essence of the contract, that he was not ready and willing to perform his part of the contract, that this is an immovable property, it can be compensated in terms of money, like that. So various, by providing discretion, certain rights were given to, substantive rights were given to the other side also. It is not a mere discretion given to the court. Certain rights were conferred on the parties. And certain liabilities were created in favor of certain persons. Now that has been substantially changed. Section 10 has been substantially changed. Section 14 has been, 16 has been changed. 20 has been changed. A new right, a relief is conferred by Section 20. So thereby, as Mr. Jayaram said, it has created new obligations. If that be so, it can only be prospective because it virtually affects the substantive right of the parties. Just to visualize, in the earlier suit, parties must have taken a lot of pleading regarding readiness and willingness, that he has violated the terms of the contract. Then even if the damage is there, he is guilty of laches, delay. Now, the defenses are taken away, does it not substantially affect the right of a party? So, thereby, the several rights were given to the defendant, to the parties under the old act, they have been taken away virtually. Some rights conferred on the parties were taken away. New obligations have been imposed. Then how to get over these decisions? I'll tell you the three decisions, first three decisions are high court decisions. We are not bound by that. It has only a persuasive effect. Secondly, those decisions were rendered in the peculiar facts and amendment of that specific provision. We do not know what are the amendments. Now, the last thing is Aadhunik Steels Limited of the Supreme Court. In that, the question whether it was a substantive right or not was not the issue before the Supreme Court. It was only a passing comment made by the Supreme Court that, as we all know, specific relief act is a procedural law. Just a casual comment made by the Supreme Court, unrelated to the main issue. So that Aadhunik Steels does not lay down the law. So thereby you can get over. That's what personally I feel. Not on the judicial side, but this is my view personally. I do not know judicially how the courts will take a different view, but this, as long as this being the position, you can definitely go by the stand that it is only prospective, not prospective. That's it. Yes. So, Mr. Jayaram, don't change your view. Stand by what you said, others also. Stand by what you said earlier, that it is only prospective. And just visualize a situation where the new act is introduced in pending suits. So that is why we discussed about the time is the essence of the contract, discretion, etc. So you can apply all those principles in the existing pending suits. Yes. So these are the important topics. Now, any doubt on the topics that we have covered? Now it's open for discussion. Yes. Anybody?
George, unmuted.
Yes. Mr. George, what do you say?
Suppose a seller and a car has entered an agreement, a registered agreement to sell this property and obtained a substantial amount as advance. But now the buyer has no money to pay the balance amount. So he can go for this substituted thing to try and find out a new buyer. Right. And if the money, the amount has gone down substantially, the market values actually crash. So if he had agreed for 20 lakhs, now he'll not even get 10 lakhs now. And he can proceed for the damages against the buyer. Right?
Yes.
Am I right?
No. Now the problem is that in the substituted performance, though I said that substituted performance is a new provision, from the very nature of the provision, it's clear that it cannot be applied with every case. There are only when performance is to be done through another person, this will arise. Or in other words, I cannot, if you are unable, if you don't, you are the buyer and you don't have the money to purchase it, you cannot have the substituted performance done through another person. Or that this sale agreement is not a situation wherein sale of purchase of properties, it cannot be an apt situation where substituted performance can be done by, can be invoked. Though statute does not make any distinction, it can only be applied in certain situations wherein getting it done through yourself or through another person is possible. You cannot substitute another person in your place, because then the contract will be virtually between these two persons, is it not? Since you don't have the money, you are getting a property, getting the car purchased from by another person.
Yes.
So that there is a substitution where a new contract comes in, that will not be possible. If on the other hand, if you enter into an agreement with another person to construct your house, you can get it performed by your engaging your employees or engaging another builder. So that's why I said a lot of interpretation are required in relation to Section 20. Yes. Anybody else? Somebody had a doubt. I saw it.
Shiva Sadish.
Shiva Shakti, yes or? Yes.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Mrs. S. Yes.
Previously, in 14 or 10, your lordship has told that incapable persons in contracts can be enforced. In quasi contracts also, there is a obligation to perform the contract by incapable, yes, or minors. That doubt is still there, sir. Means that persons are exactly the same. Already the solution is available in Contract Act. Why it is mentioned here also?
Yeah.
That is the doubt, sir.
That's in the case of quasi-contract.
Yes, sir.
Now, but does it mean that you can impose a burden on a minor? No. That's not possible. How can that be? That's not possible, Mr. Swiss. Yes. Anybody else? Mr. Abraham John, I did not see you earlier. Yes. Anybody?
Unmute you, Abraham John.
Yes.
No, I do not know whether he did not raise his hands. He did not want to thrust a question on.
I was keenly listening. What are things are going on here? Anyway, I could enter only at 11, I think, 11 or something.
Okay,
like
okay.
I want to add one thing more regarding that retrospectivity of the Indian.
Yes.
So, is there not a direct provision in the amended act which makes it only prospective?
No. There is no provision.
There is the provision to establish a new court or something like that.
Yes. Infrastructure codes.
Infrastructure codes.
20B, section
20B. Infrastructure codes, that is a provision, new provision in the amendment. If that is so, how can we treat it as giving retrospective effect?
That's also a good point, yes.
So, I think we need not go to the other principles, provisions of the enactment, amended act itself, we can safely come to the conclusion that it has got only prospective effect.
No, that even though it is a new provision, there is absolutely no reason why it should be prospective only, because by constituting a new court and being tried by a new court, he does not confer any right on anybody. Or yes. That there is no assured right to have the case tried by the same court where it was in existence. Your right to file an appeal cannot be retrospectively taken away, because the right is always determined by the date on which it is filed. But on the other hand, the matter to be tried, there is no assurance by the statute that you will try it by the same court or that you will not be tried by a special court. So that's not the change in forum does not make any difference. That will not make it procedural, substantive one only. Say, for example, a new courts are constituted. All the pending suits are tried to that, transferred to that court. That will not make any difference. Yes, anybody else? I think all are saturated, it seems. Yes, Shaukat? Saudat,
yes.
Yes, Saudat, KK, yes.
Sadhut, you can unmute yourself. Please. Yes.
So my doubt is that 20A and 41 HA, what is the difference exactly?
20?
A and 41 HA.
Let me see.
Corresponding amendments are brought in 41 HA also, sir.
20A is the infrastructure code.
Capital
A, you mean?
Capital A, sir.
Which is the other provision?
41HA, sir.
So that's
41HA. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes.
40H. Can you just repeat your question, Edwin Saudat?
Sir, 41HA and 20A.
I did not exactly get the question.
Sorry, sir.
Can you be a bit louder?
Yes, sir. 41HA and 20A difference. What is the difference between 41HA and 20A? Both says that the bar of injunction.
The 41HA is here, sir.
41A is it would impede the delay or progress or completion of an infrastructure project, or interfere with the continued provision of relevant facility related thereto, or services being the subject matter of such project. 41. Now, 41H says, originally, when equally efficacious relief can certainly be obtained by any other usual mode of proceeding except in case of breach of trust. That was the original section 41H. Thereafter comes HA. If it would impede or delay the progress of completion of an infrastructure project, or interfere with the continued provision of relevant facility related thereto or being serviced. So that's a case where injunction is refused.
Yes.
Section 41 relates to injunction refused.
It's a general case, sir.
Because otherwise what it would... Now, this is in continuation of 20A. 20A provides that injunction shall not be granted if any... if it is likely to impede the infrastructure project. Assume that, then suppose somebody takes up a contention under section 41H. So this HA is added to supplement section 20A. Otherwise, and in the absence of section 41HA, section 20A as such may not be that much effective, and that's only a consequential amendment made in support of 20A. Have you understood it?
Yes, yes. So my doubt is that 20A can be adopted by the special court. Presently, we have, is there any special court constituted, sir?
Yes, there are courts have been designated as special courts.
Yes.
Yes. In Kerala, we have notified certain courts.
So this 41HA can be adopted by our general municipal court and sub-court and all?
It can be. Yes. That is in relation to refusal of injunction. It is, I will tell you, it is not by any special court only. That's the case wherein in any suit, it has got a propensity of affecting the infrastructure project, section 41HA can be, will apply.
Okay.
To refuse an injunction.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Manju.
I think it's Sina. Sina wanted it. Yes.
Yes. Sina.
Sir, good evening, sir. My question is, sir, somewhat general in character. Sir, you said as per section 16C, the ever is ever like that ever is amended just because the parties, if they are not pleading that in their pleadings, there is some technical reason. So why we are not taking steps for amending this one, the negotiable instrument act, sir, and it's purely a technical one?
Even we don't fully agree with this amendment.
Okay.
Is it not? Personally, yes, I felt that even this amendment has more complicated things more.
Yes.
And when the decision was so clear that suits cannot be dismissed on the mere ground that the words are not reproduced, there was no necessity to have an amendment taking away the right of pleading, duty to plead.
Yes, sir.
So that why should, I think this, it should have been there. Because of the basic principle is that you can prove only things which you are specifically pleaded.
Okay, sir. So then what will be the effect of, if we are not taking that contention, sir, sir said, basic principle is that it should be pleaded and proved. So we cannot go beyond these pleadings also. So what is the relevance of that statement in the CPC, sir?
When it's now, because yes. Now the thing is that by virtue of this special statute that is given and taken away. So as far as specific suits coming under the specific relief act is concerned, this will be the provision. They are not governed by the general principle. That's all.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. Anybody else? If no other doubt, why not we wind up? Yes.
Vinod, please unmute. Vinod.
Yes.
Vinod, please unmute. Yes.
Chat box in the registration actually mandatory. Anu nuri chodi na. 17.
What is that? I did not see that question. What is that?
Performance suit file and only contract registry under section 17 and 16.
That's amended. Under the new provision, it has to be there.
Yes.
There is no change.
And that is recently explained by the Supreme Court. Because there was a recent decision of the Supreme Court dealing with that aspect, whether can you seek any relief on the basis of an unregistered agreement. And what the Supreme Court held was that in relation to reliefs under the specific relief act, it needs to, under the Transfer Property Act 53A, it needs to be registered. But not under the specific relief act. That is the latest decision. Yes.
And now all of you can unmute yourself and ask questions.
Yes. that's open to all.
Our ruling, sir, our registration went down in the ruling on the parameter, sir.
No, I just forgot. I have not written down. It recently, that is in 2020-21, this has come.
Registration is not required.
Not that. Registration is not required because 53A has been amended. Consequently, registration and related amendments act has come. So that for getting a relief under 53A, registration is absolutely essential.
Yes.
But for getting a relief under the Specific Relief Act, it is not required. That's how it has been interpreted.
Yes. Yes. That is only for performance of contract.
Contract, yes. Yes. That's a distinction.
Sir, Bombay decision AIR 1986, your lordship. 1986.
No, this is, which I'm referring to is a 2021.
No, your lordship referred to a Bombay decision.
That's regarding amendment, right? Amendment, Bombay decision, there are two Bombay decisions. AIR 1971, that's a Calcutta decision. Bombay decision is
86,
one Bombay,
CR50.
Yes.
Sir, I want to ask a question. Actually, there is agreement for sale of immovable property. The agreement is made compulsorily registrable for the purpose of seeking for remedy of specific performance. Otherwise, you will be entitled to get a return of advance amount only.
Yes.
For some time. So, sir, my question is, what about the possession when Section 49 of the Registration Act remains unamended, wherein the proviso to Section 49 says that an unregistered document, provided that an unregistered document affecting immovable property and required by this Act or by the TP Act 1882 to be registered may be received as evidence of a contract in a suit for specific performance under Chapter 2 of this Specific Relief Act or as evidence of any collateral transaction not required to be affected by registered instrument. So, what is the meaning in telling that under Section 17 an agreement for sale of immovable property is a compulsorily registrable document in order to seek a remedy of specific performance before a civil court?
Now that exactly is the decision. I don't exactly remember that. I have read it. 2021 decision is there, I'm sure. Supreme Court decision, which makes a distinction.
Yes.
Because all the statutes were not not changed.
Yes, sir.
Registration Act was changed. Now, even otherwise, the earlier principle was that even an unregistered document can be used for collateral purposes.
Yes.
That remains to be so. Yes. Say, for example, in a suit under Section 9, just to show that you were in possession, can you not rely on an unregistered document? You are not exercising a relief under the statute, under the act, and on the basis of the document, but you are only to substantiate your possession.
Yes.
Why not? It can be. That way it is distinguished.
Yes.
Just try to get that distinction, you'll understand. I noted it somewhere, but I could not get it right now.
But in Kozhikode, I am heard that someone has got remedy from Municipal Code 1 or so, by invoking the provisions of Section 49 of the Registration Act to get over the difficulty of non-registration of this.
I don't know how it is going to be.
Yes, I heard so. It is not my personal experience anyhow.
But anyway, it's a very innovative exercise of provisions.
Yes, sir. Very good. Sir, your class is very, 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 very good. And the real academician in you has come out.
probably you brought it out. You all brought it out.
So we are obliged to the core.
We, thank you. We all join in issue with Krishnavarat Maya.
Yes.
Your lordship is an exceptional teacher. Yes.
Because you don't you don't see that, Mrs. Yara, when I'm in the course.
He is a great teacher. Yes. Experienced it so many times.
Yes.
Anyway, very interesting session. Very, very thank informative.
You, thank, you, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure to be with you.
Very, very many occasions to appear before you. When you were additional pursuit.
That was my first appointment. That was my first appointment in Trishur as a first initial district judge.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
And all everybody in the bar is remembering you.
And you are a very good judgment also. And sir,
രാമചന്ദ്രൻ
വക്കീൽ ഒരു വളരെ ഷോർട്ട് ആയിട്ട് താങ്ക്സ് ഒന്ന്
പറഞ്ഞു. As all we know, nowadays in India, several laws are being amended to accelerate the capitalization, the privatization of the economy, we all know. And this is the outcome, this amendment in this act is also an outcome of such a tendency in India. And how, whatever it is, your lordship make the class or the session by distinguishing the old and amended act in such a way, even to understand the law students also. So we are very grateful and we are blessed with this type of class, your lordship. So I am expressing sincere and deep thanks to your lordship on behalf of All India Lawyers Union Kannur District Committee. And I also want to thanks all other participants who have participated in this session and sparing a beautiful Sunday with us. And thanks for on my behalf and also for the District Committee ALU Kannur. Thank you for all questions, all parts.
No, actually, it was my pleasure also being with you. My pleasure, so that we can have interact. Tangachan will persuade me like anything. he knows the technique.
Yes.
Thank you.
This is the second class with your
third class. Yes,
yes.
Okay, sir, then let us conclude the session. Let me sign off the program now.
Okay, thank you.
Yes,
thank you.